Just buzzing right through hour two on a special Wednesday edition of Liquid Lunch. Lots going on in the world and lots going on right here. I've been saying it for a while. New York is known as the city that never sleeps. And because of this pandemic, New York has been in a nap for quite some time. We're well rested, and the city that never sleeps is looked at as the city on the hill to lead the world. And we're being over and over again seeing our, you know, kind of blue state type mayors and governors here in New York call balls and strikes on who can be in business and who can't. Right here in Staten Island, New York, one business owner, Bob Catone of Sunbelievable, has agreed to open his store tomorrow, an 8-bed tanning salon. And he's going to stagger the appointments so no more than four people are in there. And I'm joined again by our council member right here, Joe Borelli, along with Frank Morano. And first and foremost, Joe, I know you're a man of your word, and I really appreciate and respect it. I know me and you were busting chops, but we're not having a rally tomorrow, okay? So it's not a gathering. We're not asking people to rally. We're asking people not to bring political signs, no Trump signs, no Biden signs. We're asking people to bring flags, come out peacefully, and stand with an owner who's, and support him, who's unlocking his business. And from what I understand, you're going to be on hand tomorrow when he unlocks it to check out the situation.
I'll be there. I'll have to buy some fresh goggles or something, but we'll be there. And, you know, look, I want this to go smoothly. I hope nothing bad happens to him, meaning a fine or something like that. But, at the very least, the governor has to know that people are pushing back. We can't wait for these not really objective metrics to be met. You know, last count, I think we were at 29% of ICU beds rather than the 30 the governor decided we needed. You know, when you think about it, there's 1,800 total ICU beds in the city of New York. So you're literally talking about 18 beds that no one's trying to get into, no one needs right now. And considering the fact that we doubled the amount of ICU beds in 2 weeks, I don't know if these 18 are that important to keep businesses closed. I don't think we should be phasing things as slowly as we are either. You know, if you really want to think about it, restaurants aren't in phase three. Not one region of the state is anywhere near phase three right now. So when we mention opening up, for a lot of businesses, that just means still staying shut.
Yeah, Councilman, one of the other things here in New York City that we're seeing remain closed is beaches, although that's not apparently stopping people from using them. Mayor de Blasio has decided city beaches are not going to reopen, at least not yet. You, I know, have been very vocal in opposing the mayor's decision to keep beaches closed. How come?
Look, I think the mistake was to not hire and train lifeguards. I mean, the beaches are not being closed for any social distancing problem. I mean, Long Island beaches are open. New Jersey's beaches are open. New York City residents will be going to both of those places and dipping their chubby feet in the water if they want, right? The reason New York City's beaches are closed is because the mayor didn't think ahead to hire lifeguards. And until they come online, I doubt you're going to see the water opening. So I think it's less of a judgment call by Mayor de Blasio today. I think it was more the results of a judgment call by Mayor de Blasio about, you know, 3 or 4 weeks ago that we shouldn't bring in our lifeguards and train them and get them ready. You know, but it just shows such a broader issue that politicians are so worried and so concerned, and we must have space so people from New York City can go sun themselves. I mean, that's great. I want the beaches to open too, but think of bigger picture. We have to get the businesses open so that we can continue to, you know, not stop the financial hemorrhaging of the city of New York.
No doubt, Joe. Attorneys tend to get a bum rap. But we got some attorneys here in Staten Island, Lou Gelamino, Mark Fonte, Mario Gallucci, well-known criminal defense attorneys who have stepped up, and their businesses are getting smacked around. They've stepped up and said, hey, we're going to stand by and represent any business owner that wants to flout the law, and we're going to represent them till we're done, till you're done. We're not going to walk away from you. What do you say when the mayor says, hey, Joe, you're one of my elected officials. How are you going against my order? What do you say to the mayor when he calls you?
Well, if the mayor just realized I'm against most of his orders today, he hasn't really opened many newspapers. Maybe he still likes me. I mean, maybe he shouldn't even.
He did give you a shout out last week in his statement about the line of duty deaths that
I. Yeah, you're right. You're right. You're right.
Council member Danique Miller.
He gave me a shout out, and on that issue, the mayor is completely right now. He's on the right side of the issue. Full stop. He's doing a good job on that issue. But, you know, we can't keep hiding behind this public safety mentality when the statistics just aren't bearing out the doomsday scenarios that they're afraid of. If you look at Atlanta, Georgia, a pretty dense city, you look at the three hardest hit counties that make up the Atlanta metro area, Gwinnett County, DeKalb County, and Fulton County, you'll see that the number of infections, hospitalizations, and deaths have all trickled off. In the weeks since Georgia has effectively reopened. So, I mean, the panic is not warranted. If those counties, right, as dense as New York, if not denser at some places, perhaps, certainly more than Staten Island, if those counties didn't see a mass rise in cases and death and disease and destruction, then why are we so positive that if we open, we reopen? By the way, reopening means continuing social distancing, but if we reopen with guidelines, why do we just pretend like there's no reason to question whether or not this pandemic will spike up again?
No doubt. Joe, so a lot of the people that are coming out to support are asking for simple things which are important to everybody in our community. One, let businesses open at 50%. Two, let churches open at 25%. And three, something that's near and dear to my heart, and I know you always tried to help me with this too, let little leagues open with no fans and no coaches. Let the kids go out there and play a game and the parents could sit in their cars and watch. And I think if you have churches, little leagues, and businesses open, the community will breathe a sigh of relief and a lot of the mental anguish that's happening will really be relieved.
John, you're right. I mean, you know, sports are important for kids. And again, most parents, I think, are pretty reasonable, right? If you told us that Greco-Roman wrestling couldn't start up again because of coronavirus, we'd all say, oh, yeah, okay, that's probably a good point, right? But you have baseball, which if you played as bad as I did in left field as a kid, it was a pretty self-isolating
game. Yeah, right. I mean, there's definitely spacing. All right, Joe. Tomorrow, I'm hoping that a lot of people come out to support Bobby. I'll be there. I know you said you'll be there. I probably, you know, when everyone finds out you're going to be there, there's going to be a media menagerie. So I've chosen a few quotes that you might want to consider for tomorrow. And then, you know, there's four of them. So let me throw them at you, okay? And you tell me if you like any of them. So in the famed Shakespeare play, Prince Hamlet uttered this soliloquy: to tan or not to tan? That is the question. Is that good?
Weak. All right. I mean, I think you got better. I think you got better in there.
Okay. So in 1775, Patrick Henry uttered the words at the Second Virginia Convention: give me tanning or give me death.
Nice. I like that one.
You like that one. Okay. Now, let's get into another level here. Jesus himself said, let he who is without son cast the first tan.
I'm leaving.
I like these.
It's not horrible, okay? And then if you're going to go to the higher power, you got to go to the man himself, the top of the food chain, God himself. In John 8:7, he said, on the first day, he said, let there be ultraviolet light.
You can't argue with the Bible, John. You can't.
I mean, do you like any of them? I think I don't think they're that bad. You know what I mean? To get a little, you know.
I like the Patrick Henry. You know, he was. I'm told he was a fan of tanning. He used to tan on Boston Common.
Better to get your master's degree rescinded than to be excommunicated from your church. That's right.
I noticed. Hey, Frank, hang on. I noticed what I said before. I have a few suggestions. Frank uttered in the back, oh boy, here we go.
Because your suggestions, irrespective of what their suggestions about, they tend to either get you in trouble or whoever you're making the suggestion to in trouble.
I can't wait to hear the real John Tobacco suggestions off air.
That's our liquid lunch after hours, Joe.
Councilman, in the final minute that we have, you ignited quite a Twitter firestorm in terms of debate over the holiday weekend about grilling. Can you describe for the viewers what the conundrum that you put forth was and what the reaction was from the social media community?
So first of all, thousands of comments on this tweet. I asked about grilling protocols. I witnessed a friend grilling. He put some meat on the grill, right? It didn't need to be flipped. It didn't need to be flipped. Okay, let's be clear about that. His father-in-law came over and picked up his utensils and decided this is time to flip this guy's meat. And I couldn't even summon the courage to say anything. I just sat there jaw dropped. If someone touched my meat, I'd be offended. And it would be a problem.
Well,
thousands of comments.
One thing, if nothing else, I know about my friend Joe Borelli, councilman here in Staten Island, New York. He does not want any other man flipping his meat. And
no, sir.
Joe, I look forward to seeing you tomorrow with the goggles and the Speedo, and I really appreciate very much you keeping your word and coming down to support local business. Thank you, Joe.
Sounds good. Thank you.
That's Joe Borelli, councilman from Staten Island, New York. He's the head of all New York State for Trump's reelection campaign, and he's coming out tomorrow to stand with a local business owner and many local business owners right here. We'll keep you posted on that. Mindy Barnett, me and Frank, right after this.